Moving between a schematic and a layout is not an easy process. There's something that we can do in the middle that helps a little bit. So what we can do in the middle between schematics and layouts is something called a stick diagram. A stick diagram uses colored sticks to represent the material used to create different tracks in the schematic. It looks kind of like a color-coded schematic in a way, with transistors being marked by the intersection of poly and active tracks instead of being marked by circuit symbols. A stick diagram is very useful because it helps indicate the materials that will be used to create different parts of the circuit. It helps us start to think about relative placement of different parts of the circuit. It helps us start to think about routing because it forces us to think about intersections between different materials and how we can get over these intersections. So it is a very good intermediate step to layouts because it can also be drawn manually. It doesn't require attention to design rules, and it does not actually encode precise positioning of different tracks, and it does not encode the sizes of different tracks, which means that it's leaving out important information, but this is information that can be taken into account when we migrate from a stick diagram to a layout. So it encodes some of the information and leaves some out, which is fine. So here we can see the colors of all the tracks we can use to draw the stick diagram. We're going to use red to indicate polysilicon. We're going to use dark green to indicate N-diffusion and light green to indicate P-diffusion. We're not going to use an active and select mask in this case. We're just going to use different colors for N-plus and P-plus, fully understanding that when a polysilicon wire and an N-plus or P-plus track intersect, we're going to have a transistor. We will use black axis to indicate contacts or vias, and we're not going to make a distinction in this case. But in some cases, standards for drawing stick diagrams will, for example, use black dots to indicate vias and black axis to indicate contacts. It's up to you, really. We'll use a dotted line to indicate a boundary between the well and the substrate so that we have to draw all PMOS transistors on one side of this dotted line and all NMOS transistors on the other side. And we will use different shades of blue and purple to indicate different levels of metal wires. So if you look at this diagram, it's just a bunch of wires in different materials. And the interesting thing here is that even though we intersect all these tracks, there's actually not a single connection being made here. So one rule of stick diagrams is that a connection is made only when there is an explicit contact or via, or when we intersect tracks of the same material with each other. If tracks of different material intersect with each other, they are just crossing over. They don't create a contact. But if a polysilicon and diffusion wire intersect, then that's a transistor. And so what we have here does not show a single connection, but it does show a single transistor actually here. This is an NMOS transistor because it is an intersection between an N-plus wire and a poly wire. So if we look at this diagram instead, we see connections being made. So all of these are connections because they are intersections between wires of the same material, and so they form connections. All of these are also connections because they include explicit contacts. We could also use different metal wires or metal levels and create vias between them, and still that would be a contact. So here we see a CMOS inverter transformed into a stick diagram. We can see that there's a lot of similarity between the schematic and the stick diagram in terms of placement. But again, the stick diagram is now showing which materials are used to make which parts of the circuit. And the layout when we see it for a CMOS inverter is going to look a little bit different from this. So the layout is going to be a little bit similar to the stick diagram, and the stick diagram is a little bit similar to the schematic. So the stick diagram is an intermediate step in the middle. We can see that this is the PMOS transistor, and it's an intersection between a polysilicon wire and a P plus section. This is an NMOS transistor. It's an intersection between polysilicon and N plus. We use a metal wire to connect the two drains together, and so we have to use explicit contacts between the metal wire and the two diffusion areas. We have a dotted line running down the middle, which is the well, so that the PMOS is created above the well boundary and the NMOS is created below it. Ground is a metal track in itself, and supply is a metal track in itself. The input is provided through metal, but then is it goes down to polysilicon so that it's provided to the two gates of the two transistors. So there are specific steps that you can follow to move from the schematic to the stick diagram. And these rules can be used to transform any circuit into its corresponding stick diagram. This will give you a very regular looking stick diagram, but as we will discover, it will not give you an optimal stick diagram. So this shows the steps we can use to transform the schematic into its corresponding stick diagram. The first step is to draw horizontal metal lines at the top and the bottom of the area that we have available. These will be the supply and ground metal tracks, and they are drawn in metal one. You don't have an option about which metal layer you draw them at. Why? There's a lot of things that we will understand about drawing stick diagrams when we start looking at standard cells. The second step is to draw a dotted line down the middle of the available real estate. This dotted line again represents the boundary between the substrate and the well. Strictly speaking, either side could be either places, but normally we draw the well on top and the substrate at the bottom to have the NMOSes near the bottom. Again, the area doesn't have to be equal in the layout, but just in the stick diagram, we usually draw it being equal because we normally have the same number of transistors in pull-up as we have in pull-down in CMOS. Step number three, we will draw P-plus and N-plus diffusion lines wherever there are transistors. We can initially at least place them wherever the transistors are in the schematic, and we will use one diffusion line per transistor, and they will be vertical. In step number four, we will draw polysilicon lines horizontally across each diffusion line that was drawn to be a transistor. This will create the transistor. In step number five, we will extend the polysilicon so that it makes a contact between the gates of the NMOS and the PMOS transistor according to the circuit. So according to it, which specific CMOS circuit we are looking at, there's always an NMOS and a PMOS which share an input. We will extend the polysilicon line a little bit towards the left for a reason that will become clear shortly. In step number six, if possible, this is advisable, but it's something that we should do. We should extend the polysilicon input that we created using metal one wires towards the outside. This ensures that we have access to the input of the circuit or the inputs of the circuit at the metal one level. This will become very valuable when we use standard cells and combine them together to form a larger circuit. We will then, in step seven, use metal wires to complete all the remaining connections of the circuit. We will connect the drains and the sources of the transistors either to each other or to supply and ground lines. So step number nine will extend the output of the circuit in metal one towards the right side of the cell. This again is a requirement of standard cell design. At step 10, we will look at any contact that happens between multiple levels. So every intersection or contact between two levels, we will add a contact or a via to indicate an explicit contact at this location. In steps number 11, we will review the circuit to make sure that if we are moving between metal wires, and this doesn't happen in this specific case, but if that happens, we do not try to make a move from a metal wire to a metal wire that is not immediately above or below it in one via. Some processes allow you to use something called stacked vias, which allows you to move from, say, metal 1 to metal 5 in one via. But many processes do not allow this, and you have to move from metal K to metal K plus 1 or metal K minus 1. If we find that, we have to expand these vias into multiple vias. In step 12, we write down the aspect ratios of the transistors on the circuit. This draws attention to the positions of the transistors, and it also gives us some sort of indication about the sizes of the diffusion and poly tracks that will be used in this case. This helps a little bit when we move to the layout.